I will just go ahead and say welcome and thank you for coming. So this is the class for solo PvP and small gang PvP. And since this is a very broad topic and I asked Jinx how to teach you stuff I needed years to train and learn for. So I made 6 different classes, and today we will start with a little bit of theory. I know theory, boring stuff, but you need to know this. Today we will just talk a little bit about comms and fleet comms. So of course, if you're going out solo, you don't have to be on comms because you're by yourself. But if you're in a duo or trio, or let's say a gang of 5, then communication is key, because every fleet member is important. And if you like to join the CTAs or the strat op pings, a little bit about fleet comm etiquette is when the FC talks, you don't. But if the grid is clear and you can see there's not much going on, you can of course like ask questions. I will leave time after this class for a little Q&A if you want. And of course I'm recording this so you can watch it all later again, so you don't miss a thing. Does anyone have any questions now? Okay, then I will just go ahead and jump right in. I will link you the ship I started with. Of course, you don't have to start with the same ship. Of course, everyone has his or her likes or his go-to ships to fly with, or you always wanted to but you didn't really know how to fit it. Or I will just start and link you the fit in fleet. So if you are not already, please join the fleet. Edward is up. It's solo PvP class 1.
Sorry, I'm a bit confused, but where do I find this fleet? I'm not so sure.
It's solo PvP class 1. You should find it with the fleet finder. I linked it in Alliance and in Dojo. I can link it again if you want. Yeah, if you open the fleet finder and press find fleets, there are like a gajillion fleets up right now. Just take your time, or you can watch the recording later, so.
Okay, I've got my available fleets, is that what I need?
Yes. That should include all our allies and alliance and corp members.
Okay, apologies to anybody else for this, but what do I do next?
Just join the fleet. You right click on my name and there's an option join fleet, and then say yes. Yeah, no worries. Hiccups are to be expected. So I'm linking you my first and one of my favorite ships in EVE. The MOA! So I want you all to click on the MOA and click on the top left row and press look for the trades tab. This is one of the most important things you will ever learn in this class. This is it says Qadari Cruiser bonuses per level, per Qadari Cruiser level of course. 5% bonus to medium hybrid turret damage. and 4% to all shield resistances. Okay, now on the same information, on the top left corner there are four rows left to the mower, where the mower name is, and I want you to click on this. If you click on the mower, which I linked in Fleet,
I cannot see this.
Exactly. Do you see it now?
No, where should I be seeing it?
In the Fleet channel. Or there's a second way to go to get where you want to go. Just open the market. And in there's hold on, yeah, in the top left there's a search bar and you can just type MOA.
Is that just MOA?
Yes, and then press on the information button.
Okay, I have it, thank you.
Yeah, no worries. Okay, in the top left corner of the entire window of this thing, there are four short lines, and this is the action button, and I want you all to click it and press Simulate Fit, which opens the fitting screen with an empty fit. And now here the magic begins. Okay, what to do with the ship now? Oh yeah, hamburger menu, right? Okay, what to do with the ship now? We have all those empty slots to fill, and what to do? So if you have all the trades tab open still, there is a good pointer to what to do with the ship. Let's start with the high slots. Now it says 5% to medium hybrid turret damage. Now you can either choose medium blasters or ray guns, but I started with blasters. The MOA was a little different back then, but that doesn't matter very much. So we will just start with the biggest guns we can possibly fit, which are the heavy neutron blasters. Because we wanna kill stuff, and we want the biggest guns we can possibly fit. Now everyone should have the fitting simulator open, and you should have all fit five heavy neutron blasters on. Yes, all five of them. We fill all the slots until we can't. When you start to PvP, the first it's a little jittery at first, because yes, heavy neutron blasters. I'll link it in Fleet. There you go. This is what you fit on the high slots for now. Now, if you look closely on the fitting screen, you can see that we use a lot of power grid. Not much CPU, but we used a lot of power grid already. But let's continue first. Now, what do we do? Because when you're solo or in a small gang, everything you bring is what you have. You cannot bring more. This is it. Yeah, I will get to that. Patience, please. So, what you bring is what you get, so you want to bring as much as you possibly can, but you also don't want to leave a little bit of room, because if you manage to kill something, you also get the spoils, and you want a little cargo in your a little bit of room in your cargo hold. But let's continue first. Let's go to the mid slots, one of the most important things, because the Moa is a shield boat, and we need to fit a shield tank, a propulsion module, and tackle mods. Oh, that's a lot for 5 mid slots. Let's try with the propulsion mod first. So we will fit a micro warp drive. This gets us around fast, and it's really good for positioning, and if you need to catch up to a distance, want to catch someone, you want a micro warp drive. I will link it in fleet. Nope. For the medium ship classes, battle cruisers and cruisers, you will want the 50mm micro warp drives. The 5mm are for frigates and destroyers. So we will fit this one. Now I want you to open the information tab of the 50 mega newton cold gas enduring micro warp drive. The description is not really important, but the attributes are. It's pretty common. It has a capacitor penalty, it has a signature radius bloom, it has gives you more speed, of course. And if you fit it on the fitting screen, you can see it's activated and the MOA goes like 1560 meters a second. And if you go in the variations tab, because if you have all the fitting skills trained already, you may want to fit a T2 micro warp drive, but I encourage you not to do that. So please go to the variations tab of the cold gas enduring micro warp drive and press compare. This opens a list of all the 50 mega newton micro warp drives in the game. Now on the left side you can order stuff. I would suggest you order by meta level first, which is on the bottom. Then we go from top to bottom. Estimated price is not super important, but we go to activation cost and take that. Capacitor capacity bonus. Maximum velocity bonus. Power grid usage and CPU usage. We will only focus on the bottom 5 if we order by meta level, which goes from 0 to 14. So on the bottom we have the micro warp drive 1, which can only be produced by with a blueprint, but that's not super important. What is important is if you go to the activation cost of the cold gas enduring micro warp drive, you can see it has 20 gigajoules less activation cost than any other micro warp drive that are not faction or dead space, which lets your capacitor live a little longer. But more to that later. Let's go and fit the ship a little further, shall we? You can close the close the compare tool and the information of the MOA and the micro warp drive. Okay, I have to admit I have a little OCD, so my fits are will look a little symmetric, but you can fit however you want. This is just an example. I will teach you how to make the most of your strengths of the ship, so you mask most of the weaknesses. And I encourage you to play with a fitting tool, with a fitting simulator or Pypher, if you want, because the more ship fittings you see, like this is one of the standard fits. I think we have even a doctrine with the same fit. I think it's the railgun fit, but it's for now. I will just give you a basic standard Moa fit. I say standard because you can do all kinds of things, and the fitting combinations are possibly endless. I remember when Eve was pretty new, people were mining in Ospreys and Moas if you wanted to, but we want to shoot stuff, so let's stay with guns. Okay, since it's a shield ship, I would suggest we go for the most forgiving shield tank you can possibly put on a ship that is a shield ship, a shield extender. Let's try this one. And since we are really cool, we fit two of those. If you have fit two of those, you can see, oh, we are a little over the maximum power grid the ship already the ship has as a maximum. Damn it! Now what to do? Okay, here's one trick. Nope. Well, you can, but they also fit really, really good on a cruiser. I'm getting to that. Easy. Okay, I want you to remove all the neutron blasters in the high slots. Oh, I know, but I just give it a minute. Now let's try something that is called gunning down or fit gun down. I will link you another my blaster, the heavy ion blaster. Let's fit five of those. Oh, look at that. It fits. Now, there are two more ways you can fit this ship. So either you go with more tank or you go with more tackle. Yeah, you have to have advanced weapons upgrade 5. Or I can link you something. Hold on. If it doesn't fit, you can go in the variations tab of the large shield extender 2, the Tech 2 one, and you find a large F-Tech S9 Regulus compact shield extender and fit two of those. They're easier on the fitting. No, I would just use the other shield extenders. No implants required. Shouldn't at least. This class is about fitting ships. Okay, I will just go ahead and fit a little more tank, but we don't have much more room for one of those shield extenders, so let's try something else instead and use shield resistances, because the Moa Traits tab said it has a shield resistance bonus per Kadari cruiser level. So we already have more sheet resistances than any other cruiser. And we want to fit an adaptive invulnerability field. This one. The adaptive invulnerability field 2. Doesn't need much power grid. But it increases your shield resistances more. And if you have it open, you can see on the right side on the fitting screen on the defense which is in the middle. You can see it's it rose to 2800 EHP already. But we also need something to not let our victim escape. We will fit a warp scrammer for that, which is a two-edged sword, because it turns off micro jump drives, micro jump drive field generators, and micro warp drives. But this is what we want. I link it in Fleet. It's the warp scrammer Tech 2. But if you can't use this one right now, you can use this one. They only define range, so so you have to be like 1 kilometer closer to your victim to make sure it doesn't escape. Now we only have 4 low slots and the rig slots left. So let's go to the low slots. We want to make sure we make as much damage as we possibly can. And in order to do that, let's increase the weapon strength. For hybrid turrets, this would be the magnetic field stabilizer. This one. Those have a stacking penalty, which means the more you fit, the less effective they get. As a rule of thumb, I would suggest on a shield ship, don't fit more than 3, because it's probably useless, and there are other things you can put in the low slots, but let's fit the MOA first. So 3 of those magnetic field stabilizers. Okay, we have 1 low slot left. And I don't like the tank. Maybe we can have a little more tank. More tank is always good, because this is what we call a buffer fit, and the second someone shoots back, your buffer starts to diminish, and you want it to be as high as possible so you can last as long as possible. So we fit the magic Joker mod. A damage control. If you can use the Tech 2 one, just use the IFFA compact damage control. Cost a little more, but they also drop as mission loot or in asteroid belts. Now look at that. Now our EHP rose to 3400. Very good. But we still have rig slots to fill. There are lots of options, but for now, and since you're by yourself and by yourself only, I would suggest we just increase our buffer as much as possible and go to the shield rig section, which you can find down below. We go to the medium shield rigs, and fit one of those. It's not super popular, but in case you encounter a laser boat and the laser boat shoots back, you want to have high EM resistance. And we only have two rig slots left, which I suggest we fit the medium core defense field extender. And now we have fit our first ship. Now if you look on the defense, on the fitting screen, on the fitting simulator, you can see our EHP rose to 4600, 213 EHP. And you can see... No, one. Two shield extenders and one EM rig. You just need one. Sometimes you don't even need the EM one. You can fit three extenders. But that's a little taste thing, and I leave that up to you and experiment a little bit. Okay, now we have fit our ship. All the modules are filled. And now I want you to hover your mouse cursor over the medium ion blaster tech 2 and click on information. There we have the description of the heavy ion blaster 2. And in the top row there's used with, which opens a list of all the armor types you can use with a medium hybrid turret. We will focus our attention to the Tech 2 ammo because it does the most damage, or it gives a little range advantage. The range advantage ammo would be null for the medium hybrid turret. This. And you can just drag from this list onto the fitting screen and it will fill your guns with the ammo. It will show you 5.25 meters optimal range and fall off range, but I will explain turrets in a later class. And the thing you've all been waiting for, the high damage ammo, void. You can just drag it onto the fitting screen and it will replace the null ammo with the void ammo. There you go. And now we have a mower that does 550 DPS. Sweet! Now, on the fitting simulator there's a circle kind of thing which I want you to press now. There's a circle coming up. There's an offline, online and an overheat switch on the top three of those half on the pie pieces of pie. And I want to press want you to press the right one with the the overheat button. This will overheat your top rack, your guns, and you do more damage. 632.8 DPS. So this is the most you can possibly do with the mower. Oh wait, we have a drone bay. If you can use drones, almost forgot about that, sorry. Let's fit drones. The most popular drones for doing the most damage you can possibly do are the Galente ones. So this will be the Hobgoblin. You can fit three of those inside. And there you go. your damage increased from 630 to 692 DPS, which is the maximum the MOA can do with blasters. And now you have fit your first solo PvP ship. Now, what I want you to do is hover your mouse cursor over one of the heavy ion blasters. It shows the range and the damage type it does, like thermal and kinetic, and it also shows you how much rounds you have in your gun, which will be 120. So you have 120 rounds, which is a lot, so you can shoot for quite a while. And since you don't want to run out of ammo during a fight or on your way, if you're still alive. And as a rule of thumb, I would suggest you bring two reloads of ammo with you. So 5 times 120 is 600, so you put 600 or 1200 rounds of void and null inside your cargo hold. And one important thing is the Tech-2 armor has a slight penalty for being Tech-2 and like the cool ammo. It has less, it gives the turret bad tracking. So let's bring a little bit of high tracking ammo so you can track. I will teach you about tracking in the next class. So I will just tell you to bring 1200 rounds of this. I know this is all a little bit confusing for the first time, but in my experience your ship won't last longer than 2 reloads, if any. And yeah, you shouldn't like overload your ammo, because this can get more expensive than the entire ship. Now that we have our PvP ship ready to go, at least on the filling screen, let's talk a little bit about tanking. So this Morphit is fit with 2 shield extenders and an invulnerability field, which increases the EHP. EHP is what you want, at least for this kind of fit. There are 2 kinds: the buffer fit and the active tank fit. Let's do an active tank fit so you can see the differences. And I know this is confusing, but you will see it will make sense in just a few minutes. So what I want you to do is you remove the 2 shield extenders from the fit and the invulnerability field. Now we fit a large shield booster. This one. And we can see, no, this looks really terrible because we get a light warning about the capacitor, which depletes in 28 seconds, which would be terrible in a fight. So we have to manage our capacitor a little bit. For this purpose we fit a capacitor injector. This one. We are slightly above our maximum fitting limit again. So we have to downgrade our shield booster. For now, we use this one. And I want you to remove two of the sheet extender rigs we fit earlier. And I want you to remove the micro warp drive. Okay, we will fit some different rigs, which will be supporting our capacitor use on the shield extender, on the shield booster. Which will be the medium core defense capacitor safeguard. So this rig will make the shield booster use less capacitor per cycle. Okay, we have one more mid slot, and we are slightly above our maximum fitting limit, so we have to forgo the damage control in this case. It's not a problem. We just unfit the damage control and fit a module that slightly increases our power grid and shield and overall capacitor. It's such a cool mod, you will love it. The power diagnostic system. Now it fits. Now we only have one more mid slot to fill, and since we just lost the damage control, I would go for the invulnerability field again. Or you can fit a stasis verifier. For now, if since you are beginners, I would just forgo the stasis verifier. I will teach you about the stasis verifier in the next class, and fit the invulnerability field again. Now our shield resistances look almost like they looked before. Which is very good, but our capacitor still looks like really terrible. But fear not. On the fitting screen, you can see all the modules in the mid slot section are highlighted green, which means they're active. So if you click on the micro warp drive twice, it goes into four stages. It goes to it starts with active. If you click again, it goes to overheat, and then it goes off. I want you to turn it off now. The other mod is offline, which you can also do, but this is a tactic for a later class. For now, just turn off the micro warp drive. And our capacitor lives a little bit longer. Okay, to increase our capacitor life, we use capacitor charges. Those. You can just click on the Navy Cap Booster 800. And it has a nice icon, and you can drag the icon on the fitting screen, which goes into the cap injector. And lo and behold, our capacitor is stable again. Whew. So as long as you have cap charges, your capacitor lives and your shield booster lives. The Moor has room for 16 of those charges in the cargo hold. Phew, now the ship is full until until the last possible thing you can possibly fill it with. Yes, I said you are supposed to fit the invulnerability field again. This one. Yeah, no worries. So, on the fitting screen, you can see now our fit is stable, which means that as long as you have a cap charge loaded, the shield booster keeps you running. But the shield booster doesn't prevent you from dying; it just slows it down, hopefully long enough for you to kill your opponent. Now, this is just an example for an active tank or an active shield tank. And the tricks you can do to increase your survivability. Now the MOA isn't quite suited for an active tank because yeah, this is something for a later class. Not yet. The MOA isn't quite suited for an active tank because the damage on the field has increased quite a lot, and I would just go for the buffer tank because it gives you a lot of breathing room. I mean, you are on a clock. When your shield buffer runs out, you're basically toast. But it lets you live long enough to like kill most of your opponents, which will be sabers or frigates or the. Yeah, you can also engage Tech 1 cruisers, but you have to be like careful what you engage. I would just go with frigates and destroyers first, which will be your prime target and your engagement range for now. Choose wisely, because it is a destroyer, but the Kikimora is just don't. So an active tank has a slight advantage over the buffer tank. Because most of the time, if you on a battleship level, it lets you live longer than a buffer fit. Buffer fits on battleships are not very good. On the Moa, it's very good. And if you are in a fleet and you have Logi, you can rely on your fleet buddies to keep you alive. And if you kill someone and you still have most of your shield buffer left, let's say your shield goes down to 50%, the shields will regenerate over time. You don't have to do anything, you just have to wait. So once you're experienced and you do this more often, you can just warp around a little bit and make bookmarks on the way, somewhere in the middle of nowhere. You warp between those bookmarks. I will teach you about this in a later class, of course. And you can basically wait until your shields are full again, and then your ship is as good as new. That's why I chose the Moa. It's very forgiving and it does a lot of damage if you want. And you can just continue your roam. You don't have to have cap charges, because once your cap charges run out, your roam is over. And so is your ship. Now those are the two kinds of tanking you can do as in a small fleet, in a small gang, and by yourself. In a bigger fleet you have logistics and all that stuff, but we won't concern with that right now, because as I said, what you bring is what you have, and there's not more. This is all you got. In time you will learn active tanks on frigates a little preferable, because you have, like, for armor frigates, you have the ancillary armor wrap and what I suggest is to keep you alive as long as possible. You overheat the adaptive invulnerability field, which increases your EHP to above 50,000, which is quite a lot. So even if you are fighting three frigates at once, you will probably kill them all before they kill you. Another thing about solo PvP is there's a lot of adrenaline going through your veins, and you will probably not do it all right at once at the first time. You will probably go into a panic mode and probably start shivering. I know that feeling. I've had that. And I still get the adrenaline rush whenever I go into combat. Even if I know I can win, but still, it's, you never know what's going to happen. Like, in a later class I will teach you like how to separate small gangs, so you can like take on small gangs when you're a little more experienced. And you can make them really, really sad because they thought, haha, we are four people and you're just one head. Oh shit. Basically. yeah, so much for tanking. Heat. Heat is a big topic. I just said when you're fighting, you should overheat your adaptive invulnerability field. And you can overheat almost all modules which are highlighted green on the fitting screen. Now, you have to be very, very careful if when you overheat guns on a cruiser, because they won't last very long. There's a red cycle appearing on your guns whenever you shoot, and the cycle will continue until it offlines your guns, and then you're screwed, because your guns are offline and you cannot shoot anymore. So if you have the skill thermodynamics skilled, you shouldn't overheat until like you have a half circle. If you see a half circle, you should have to, you should turn off the heat on your guns and just leave it at that. However, you can overheat tanking mods for quite a while, but you cannot overheat the micro warp drive for a very long time. It lasts like 4 or 5 cycles. You have to be really, really, really careful with the micro warp drive, and I suggest you don't overheat it at all. Just go with the base micro warp drive, just turn it on and off as you need. If you need to like position yourself different, or you have to catch someone and he's like 50k away, do you activate your micro warp drive, but don't overheat the micro warp drive. I urge you not to do that until you have much more experience and have a feeling on how long your modules last. Because if once your module is offline, you need to repair it first, and when you are like roaming by yourself in NullSec, you won't always have a station or a tether to repair yourself. So keep that in mind. If you have thermodynamics trained to level 5, you can overheat the invulnerability field, however, for like 5 minutes, which is a really, really long time in PvP, but you will, once you do that for the first time, you will see how time appears different when you're in an adrenaline rush. I'm sorry, what? Comms is, hold on. It's the Dojo channel. Yeah, so much for fitting. Those are the basic things about fitting and heat. And so much for the theory. I now leave the floor open to you, because we have a little bit of time for a little bit of Q&A. And if you have questions, you can ask them now. Nobody has any questions? Is everything clear so far? That is awesome. And this concludes my first class. Yes, it's over. Thank you all for coming. Thank you. I'm planning a next class in 2 weeks.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome. Have a nice evening, everyone. And thank you for coming.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks.